Hello everyone, this is Mirzai from Cal Poly Pomona, and in this lesson we are going to learn sensitivity analysis of a linear programming problem. In the series of videos related to the sensitivity analysis, we are in part 2, where we explore 6 changes in a linear programming problem parameters that might change the optimal solution. In this lesson, we are going to explore change 6, which is adding a new constraint in your problem. 3 things might happen when a new constraint is added to a linear programming problem. The first condition that can happen is that by adding a new constraint, the current optimal solution satisfies the new constraint. The second condition that can happen by adding a new constraint is that the new optimal solution does not satisfy the new constraint, but LP still has a feasible solution. The third condition is that the additional constraint causes the LP to have no feasible solution. So let's see how we could identify these 3 possible scenarios and how we can deal with them. Before we get there, I want to give you a visual explanation of what happens in each of these scenarios. Suppose this is the optimization problem that you're given, and this is your feasible region. And this is your objective function line, and as you exit the feasible area, the last point that you're hitting is this corner point, and this becomes your optimal solution. Now, by adding a new constraint, different situations can happen. For example, if this is a new constraint that you're adding, nothing is going to change in terms of your feasible region or the optimal solution that you have in place. This is the first condition. You're not taking anything off of your current feasible solution, and it remains exactly the same way that it was before. Sometimes, however, your new constraint is going to cut off some part of your feasible region, but it's not going to cut the optimal solution. As you see in this scenario, nothing is going to change in terms of our objective function value, because the optimal solution happens in the corner that has not been cut or removed by the new constraint. So again, we are in the first scenario. Sometimes, however, the new constraint is going to cut off the part that also includes the objective function. In this scenario, we are in the second case that we explained earlier, where you're still going to have a feasible solution. You're going to have an optimum point, which is somewhere in this new feasible region, but it's not going to be something that you already had. Your problem is still going to have a feasible optimal solution, but it's not going to be as good as what you originally had. Another situation that can happen is that the new constraint that you have makes the problem infeasible. In this scenario, as you see, the new constraint is imposing an area which doesn't have any intersection with the previous feasible area. So in this scenario, there is no intersection between all these regions in the first quarter of your coordinate system, because remember that for a linear programming problem, your x1 and x2 is always positive, and we are trying to find the intersection of all these lines in the first quarter of the system of coordinates. Now in this scenario, you see that there is no intersection between all these 3 regions, and this, in fact, adding this new constraint has voided the previous feasible region. So in this scenario, we are looking at the condition 3, where adding a new constraint makes the problem infeasible. So now maybe I can raise this question. Is there any way to improve the results of the objective function by adding constraints? You might pause this video and think about the answer of this question. But as you notice, by adding a new constraint, we never get to a situation that we can actually improve the result of the original problem, because every time we are adding more restriction to the feasible region, and that would never result to improvement of your objective function value. Therefore, the new objective function value at most will be the same as what we had before. So let's go to the first condition and see how we can deal with the first condition, where adding a new constraint is not going to cut our optimal point from the feasible region. So suppose that this is the current optimal solution that is given for the linear programming problem shown on the screen, and our task is to investigate how a new constraint is going to impact our optimal solution. So if I replace this optimal solution in the new constraint and it satisfies the constraint that is given, then it means that my current optimal solution is going to remain feasible and therefore is not going to change. Because as you notice, when we are not cutting off the optimal solution, it means that our result is not going to change and we are in the same optimal corner points. So in this case, the value of x1 is 2 and the value of x3 is 8. Let's replace these values in the constraints that is given and see whether it satisfied the condition or not. As you see, 2 plus 8 is 10 and is less than 11. And since the current solution is still feasible, it is optimal too, because we are not cutting off the optimal point from the feasible region. You can think about that visual representation that we had earlier, that we are not cutting off our optimal point, so the current optimal remains feasible. Now let's go to the second condition and see what happens when we actually cut the optimal point, but then we still have a feasible region, which for that we can find a new optimal solution. How we can identify that? So every time that you're given a new constraint, the first thing that you want to do is to test the result of the optimal result in your new constraint and see whether it satisfies the constraint or not. If it does, then you're remaining in the same optimal corner. But if it doesn't satisfy, it's where the second condition happened, where the new optimal solution does not satisfy the new constraint, but you still have a feasible solution. So in the second scenario is where we cut the optimal solution, but still we have a feasible region for which we can find an optimal point. So let's say this time you have the same optimization problem and the same optimal table, but the new constraint that you're adding is x2 greater than 1. x2, because it's a non-basic variable, you don't see it in the pool of basic variables here, meaning that it's non-basic and its value is equal to 0. Therefore, 0 is not greater than 1, so the optimal result that you have found here is not feasible with the new constraint anymore. It means that you have cut off the optimal solution from your feasible region. Still, we don't know to what extent we have reduced the feasible area. Do we have a feasible solution with this new constraint, or the whole feasible region has been forfeited with the new constraint? To test for that, we have to add this new constraint to the system of equations and basically see the impact by adding this new constraint. The way that we solve this, we always take advantage of dual simplex method, because we have optimality condition here. The way that we handle this is by multiplying this by negative 1 and adding a slack variable to standardize it, and then adding this to our system of equations here. Now, the way that you add this new constraint is you have to add a row and a column. The row and column that you're adding is basically related to S4, because S4 is a basic variable in this new constraint that you have generated, where it gets a value of negative 1 under x2, and also it has a value of 1 under s4, and the right hand side is negative 1. Now you have the optimality condition in the row of z, you have a negative value in the right hand side. That's the sign that we can use dual simplex. Now we have to continue using dual simplex. The most negative value in the right hand side is negative 1. And the only value that is negative in this row that I can implement the minimum test is negative 1. So the first column becomes my pivot column as well. Now, if you don't know what are the details of the dual simplex, please refer to the dual simplex video. And there we explain the steps for implementing a dual simplex method. Now, if I iterate and go to the next table, this is a new table that you get. You see that from 280, the objective function reduced to 275. It means that by adding a new constraint, you actually cut off your optimal point, and the new optimal point, which its value is lower than the original one, is 275. Now let's investigate the third condition, where you don't have a feasible solution anymore by adding a new constraint. So let's say we're adding a new constraint in our LP, and is x1 plus x2 greater than or equal to 12. So in this scenario, if I replace x1 and x2, x1 is 2 and x2 is 0. So you have 2 greater than or equal to 12, which is not feasible. Therefore, we don't have a feasible solution for the problem using by adding this new constraint. It means that we have cut off the feasible region that includes the optimal solution. But we cannot conclude that we don't have a feasible solution for this problem yet. We have to add this to the system of equation and solve for it and figure out whether by imposing this new constraint, are we forfeiting the whole feasible region, or are we just cutting off a portion that includes the optimal solution? to be able to do that, again, if you have a greater than or equal, since we don't want to go through the bigger than two-phase method, we try to use the dual simplex. For that, we have to generate a negative right-hand side. We already have the optimality condition in the row of z, but we just need some negative in the right-hand side to be able to use the dual simplex. To do that, I multiply this equation by a negative 1, and this is the new equation that you get. Now I have to add a slack variable to standardize this equation. If I do this a step, then you get S4, which represents for the fourth constraint. And now we have to add this in the system of equation that we already had. So this is our optimal table by adding a new row and column for S4, because S4 is the basic variable in the new constraint that we added in our system of equations. Now, since we have a negative right-hand side, we can pivot for this row. And by implementing the minimum test, we realize that the pivot column is going to be the third column, because you have two negative values here that you can implement the minimum test. 0 divided by negative 1 and 5 divided by negative 1. So we implement the iteration and we go to the next table by pivoting over negative 1. In this table, you see that your objective function hasn't changed because we had a degeneracy condition. When we get them 0 for our minimum test in the previous table, it's a sign for degeneracy, meaning that our optimal value hasn't changed, our objective function value hasn't changed. However, our basic variables has changed. Now in this new table, we still have a negative right-hand side, meaning that we have to continue this table. So this time, as you see, your negative 12 has changed to negative 10, but we still have a negative value, so we have to still pivot over this negative value. And this time, the only negative value in the pivot row is negative 1/2, so we pivot over this column, and we continue to the next table. And as you see, the value of objective function has reduced to 80 this time, and we have two negative value in the next table that we have to implement the dual simplex. So this time we give the most negative value in the right hand side and pivot over the negative value in this row, and we go to the next table. Then next table, you still have a negative value in the right hand side, and you if you try to pivot over this value, you have negative 20. But when you try to implement the minimum test, as you know, for a dual simplex, the minimum test happens on the negative value of the pivot row, but there is no entering decision variable in this scenario, because you cannot implement the minimum test. You cannot find a negative value in the pivot row to implement your minimum test. Therefore, you have an exiting decision variable, but you cannot enter anything. That's a sign for infeasible solution for your problem. So therefore, since there is an exiting decision variable but no entering variable, the LP doesn't have a feasible solution with the constraint added. So when you add in a new constraint to your linear programming problem, first you have to test whether your optimal solution satisfies the new constraint. If it does, nothing is going to change in terms of your final solution. However, if your current solution doesn't satisfy the new constraint, you'll have to add that constraint to the system of equation and start to solve the problem by considering that new constraint. Now, when you solve this problem, you might run into two different conditions. You either find a new optimal solution, which is the second condition that we investigated, which the result of the objective function is not going to be something more than what you originally had. Or if you continue solving the problem, you might run into a condition that you have an exiting decision variable, but you don't find an entering decision variable, which in dual simplex is a sign that you don't have a feasible solution for your original problem. With this, our lesson in sensitivity analysis, part 2, adding a new constraint to a linear programming problem, has concluded. Please refer to your blackboard for your assignment. Thank you.